put something in their toolbox, they actually understand, hey, you know what? Science is not against God. When you study what real science is, there's not any science to prove any of it wrong. And we need to see that. Last class, and this is a class, this is kind of anywhere you're at, you can go through this class. But if you're brand new, you can do it. I would recommend either this one or Bible Made Simple if you're brand new to Tuesday night classes. And I'm going to be teaching this class, and I'm pretty pumped about it. It's called Elements. And we're going to learn the elements of discipleship. We're actually going to learn what it looks like to be a Christian, and you don't want to miss that on those Tuesday nights. So I just wanted to get some of that out of the way today. And you're going to have those opportunities online here in the next couple weeks to see those classes, sign up for those classes, and to see the small groups and sign up for the small groups. Woo! I got that done. Next announcement. You guys are nervous. God, that brisket's been on for a while. Oh, Lord. You don't want to miss this week. Now, we did not have tons of people at prayer meeting this week, but that's okay because we kind of called it a little bit on a whim and said, look, if we're going to have revival services, we want to get our hearts in the right place. And we have had some awesome prayer meetings around here this week. Come on, if you were at prayer meeting this week, did you enjoy it? There you go. God poured out, God moved. There were some days in there I told them to. You know, you come in, you feel discouraged, and then you're in the presence of God for just a few minutes, it changes your total outlook on everything. It really does. It gives you hope. It really does in hard situations. And we're going to do another prayer meeting on Tuesday night, and we're going to do that at 7 o'clock this week because the rest of our services this week are going to be at 7. So we're going to do that when it's 7 o'clock Tuesday night. Don't want to miss it. It's going to be good. It's going to be a simple prayer meeting just like we had this past week. But we're going to be praying into, and I want to invite anyone that wants to come. Our leadership's going to be here praying. We're going to pray into this event this week. Because this is, what this event is, this is not the great revival that we're speaking about. What do you mean? It says summer revival. It's a name. You give it that. We title it that. But this is the spark that we need for God to get us in the right spot as a church body so that we can see revival throughout our city. I believe this is just the beginning. Somebody was saying the other day, I can't wait for that revival to come, and I want to tell you something. I'm looking around the United States right now. We're doing great in Texas. God bless Texas. Amen. But there's a lot of places where people are they're getting pressured right now. Maybe you shouldn't go to church. Maybe you shouldn't do those types of things. And in those places where that squeeze is beginning to happen, God is beginning to do great signs, wonders, and miracles. And that's why Wednesday night, I want to cast a little vision. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about opening the eyes of our hearts. But this Wednesday night, I'm going to cast a little vision about what that might look like throughout our city and what God wants to do. Come on. I want to be used of God. I want to be used of God. And then so that's Wednesday night. The Thursday night you don't want to miss. As seen, I always joke around and say this because he would feel uncomfortable if I said this, but I'm gonna do it anyway. As seen on TV, Clifton Lejeune, all the way from Jennings, Louisiana, is gonna be here preaching to us Thursday night. I'm excited about that. I'm gonna tell you why, because I've heard him preach before. Let me tell you something. You're going to walk away with something. You're going to be enlightened and you're going to be empowered. Don't miss that. Church, come on. We ought to all come out this week. We ought to set aside some time and just say, you know what? I'm going to give my life. I know your kids, some of them in two-a-days, you ought to pick them up from practice and bring them to church sweating. Come on. That's how my dad was. My dad was like, boy, you better be at church. And my football coach knew something because my dad had an understanding with it. We have church at 7 o'clock on Wednesday nights, coach. Yes, sir. And he was a very serious coach. He was about the football, son. We were a very serious program. But he knew on Wednesday nights, I got to make sure that dude is at youth service by 7 o'clock. And I kid you not, our coach made sure we were out. He'd look at me and go, Nelson, get to the shower. Don't walk. Made sure we got to church on Wednesday nights. Come on, maybe some of y'all look at your coaches and say, hey, I love you, but as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We don't serve football, right? I know we got some coaches in the room probably looking back at me right now going, yeah, well, plan your revival on another date. No, I'm kidding. Don't miss it, though. Listen to me. And then Friday night, I'm gonna do it like this because I've heard him say it before. He'd take the microphone. This guy's been speaking into my life since I was just a little boy. I've heard him take a microphone, and he just takes it and goes, get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready. And the place goes crazy. And all he said was, get ready. Why? Because people know the ministry that is about to be poured out. Let me tell you something. There's prophetic ministry there. There's a power, signs, wonders, miracles. Jonathan Suber, Friday night. Don't miss it. You need the Holy Ghost. You got somebody in your life that needs to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to talk about that a little bit today. You need somebody that needs healing. That Friday night is the night that we are focusing on that. I believe God's going to pour out His Spirit. But here's the question. Do you have the expectation that meets what God wants to do? There's been some times where I've heard of preachers going into situations. Even Jesus had some situations where there were people in the room where he's trying to lay hands on somebody and have them and see them healed and had to look at everybody in the room and say, get out. Why? Because you got doubt, and I don't need your doubt right now. And you may have heard, oh, I've heard of revival before. I've heard of revival before. I hear people talking about it right now. Let me tell you something, guys. Looking around the world right now, what's going on? I see a great now. Now, somebody, you think it's the end time revival? Probably so. But even if it's not, you can see the season we're in right now, and we're entering a season of revival. It's already beginning in many places. I don't know about you. Any of you guys have FOMO? Wave at me if y'all know what FOMO is. That's fear of missing out. When you're younger, that causes you to do stupid stuff. Like, you know, jump off of roofs, onto a trampoline, crazy stuff. Me and had this. The other day we were watching something, and it was a documentary or something, and a guy went and did something crazy, and my wife looked at me and she goes, and this is why men live shorter lifespans than women. This right here, y'all do stupid, stupid stuff. It's because men have FOMO. We have that. A lot of us have FOMO. What? I don't want to miss out on. And when it comes to the kingdom of God, when I'm watching social media and I'm watching God pour out His Spirit all over the place, I sit there and I look at that and I go, God, I want that right there. Come on, I want that right there. And if you see that and you don't want that in your life, like, you really need to check some things in your life. Because we chase after so many things that do not matter in our lives. And I'm guilty of that also. I've been convicted this week over some things. And just God's moved on my heart a little bit. Like, let some things go. Like, there's just some things that don't matter. I mean, if I got about 70 to 76 years on this earth, but I have eternity in heaven, which one should I focus on more? See, a lot of folks are trying to get all their kicks while we're on this earth, but the truth of the matter is, I believe that God wants us to focus on eternal life, and if we'll store up for ourselves treasures in heaven, we are not going to regret it when we get there. Because I can have a little bit here. I'm not just talking about money right now. I'm talking about just our time, treasure time, all those things. I'm on earth and I'm just here for my own enjoyment, which happens to many of us very often. We get focused on what makes me happy, and the fact of the matter is I'm missing out on so much because, like one old timer said, you know, I don't care if I have to live in an outhouse in heaven, I'm just going to be happy to be there. That is true. But we're talking eternity, man. I'll be honest with you, I've been in an outhouse before. I've told this story before. Me and Denzel, and we were up in the lower Himalaya, in the foothills of the Himalayas in Southeast Asia, And we woke up one morning, we were tore up with mosquitoes, and he said, man, where are these mosquitoes coming from? I look out the back window, that we're, there's no electricity where we were. We looked out down at the second story, there's a house behind us. There was a pig pen and an outhouse right under our windows. I said, Denzel, did you get your shots before we came? He said, nope. I said, yeah, me neither. In the name of Jesus. I don't want to, I want to get to heaven. I want a mansion in heaven, man. Come on. I don't know about you, but if I'm going to spend eternity there, I want it all there. And today I'm wondering, like, are the eyes of our hearts open? And today we're focusing more on making that maximum impact. Everybody say maximum impact. It kind of sounds like a movie, and that's because it is. But I told you last week, we can't really, I can't really show you any clips of the movie. It came out in 2017. But it was one of those Danny Trejo films, and that's like Machete. Anybody seen that movie? Good. You're all good Christians. You didn't go watch people get hacked up, you know. But guys, I want to ask you the question, are you making a maximum impact in the world around you? What I mean by that is really the only impact worth making is a kingdom impact, is a heavenly impact. Yeah, I can feed people. I can do all that. We did that this week. And by the way, I got a text message back from Bob at Shepherd's Heart. Served over 110 families this week. Come on. He comes to me at the end. He said, I think we had almost 100 people that we served today. Gave me a message back. He said, after we went back through our paperwork, man, it was more like 117 families. Groceries for the week. I'm so glad that we could team up with Shepherd's Heart and be a distribution location for helping people who are hungry and a hard time. It would surprise you how many nice cars pull through that line, and they look at you and they go, I'm working, I'm doing all I can, but I'm a single parent, and I can't quite make the ends meet anymore. And this is an opportunity. And I wonder this morning if we're really willing to open the eyes of our hearts, if we're really willing to see things the way God sees them. And I ask that question because I know it's easy to say yes, but this morning I kind of wonder if you just do a little self-reflecting. And I know this is Revival Week and we're looking for a wild, exciting message today, and you're going to get that Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, but today, what we have to do, but Dad said it best on Tuesday night. He was talking about Brother Tenney. He said, Brother Tenney would tell people that, we used to tell preachers that all of you, a lot of you preachers would have revival in your church if you just have a good solid outpouring of, or a good solid commitment of repentance in your church. And the reason a lot of us aren't really having revival in our lives is because there's not really a heart for repentance. And I'm not pointing fingers this morning. Instead, I'll put myself in the category with you. The fact of the matter is that I understand life. Life is life. You face things in life. You face situations in life. It's easy to get distracted. Kids going back to school. You got kids. I got a kid in swim practices over here. I got one plays soccer over here. Got one does ballet over here. And I hear they're all about to start piano lessons this semester too. See, we do it right. We're thinking this out. See, my girls are 7 years old. They'll be 8 this year. And the way I see it is that you can go do that sports and do all that stuff too. But we're also going to get you some piano lessons because, hey, I need to make sure I got some future musicians up in here, man. I can't wait to look back one day and see my kids. Come on, I'm trying to cast some vision to you for a second. I can't wait to look back one day and see my kids behind me going, will you, Dad? Let's go reach the world. Come on, Dad, let's go do something that matters more than just my own life and my own desires. I'm not looking for happiness in this life because I realize this earth can't provide it. And there's so many people searching for happiness. I've said this a lot in relationship series. We're about up for another relationship series soon. But I've said it before, relationship series. If you're looking at your spouse to bring you happiness, you have the completely wrong mindset for what marriage is. My wife could witness to that.
Yeah, I know. Somebody wanted to laugh a little bit right there. What are you saying? Oh, she could tell you, I make her unhappy often. What does that mean? I'm disobedient. I'm hot-headed. I have all those issues. They're all in there. But I'm not in this marriage. She's not in this marriage. We're not in this to make each other happy. No, at the end of the day, we're in this to help each other reach the purpose that God has put in our lives. And I want to ask you today, like your relationship with church, your relationship with the people around you, is it furthering your relationship with God, or is it harming your relationship with God? And I'm not even getting into relationships today. I'm going to talk about that in a few weeks as we launch small groups, sign-ups, and do all that stuff. But this morning, I wonder, like, what is it? Where's the signal? Anybody here remember having, before satellite radio, some of you still, I don't have satellite radio now. You know, now if the signal's messed up, it just freezes for a second. But back in the day, and still to this day, if you're riding down the road and you're listening to Shooter FM 92.9, the Young Guns and Legends of Country. And you're riding down the road. Now, some of y'all are listening to K-Love. That's good for you, okay? Good for you. That's awesome. You're a little more saved than I am, maybe. I don't know. But you're riding down the road and you're going back east or something and you're on Highway 7 and headed over into the woods, and after a minute you start going, and you handle it for a little while. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Like you're okay with it and you get halfway through that song and it's singing, I got a... It's plain to see. Like, what was that line in there, you know? I missed that, you know? See, what happens is, though, in our relationship with God, though, sometimes our signal gets messed up. Our signal gets messed up because we've gotten too far away from the tower. Our signal gets messed up because I've let too many things get in between me and that tower. I've let too many things in, and I've got to push some things out sometimes. And that's why in January we do 21 days of prayer. It's why right now we're coming into this semester in revival. And the reason why is because I believe at these points of time, it's seasons that God has put us in, that God wants us to remove some things and get focused. I don't think God minds you having a good time. I really don't. But I think there's times where he goes, all right, you had a good time. That's good. Now, hey, come here. Look at me, because right now I got something for you to do. And I want to tell you right now, I don't individuals in this church, church member in this room, I'm not just speaking to a broad audience, I'm speaking to you. I want you to say me. Now, some of you are already plugged in and you're already getting going in your life. Good. That's awesome. Keep it moving. But I'm speaking a whole lot today to the people who haven't quite stepped in totally, and I want to encourage you today to do that. What has to happen is the eyes of my heart. God, you got to open my eyes so that I can see. And I believe it's my job to clear the signal so I can hear. And a lot of you in this room, you're probably thinking, yeah, well, I'm not gifted in that prophetic stuff, like all that hearing from God. No, I believe that everyone in this room can be led of God. I'm sorry, that's not just for some to be led of God. No. The Bible says that a righteous man, that a good man's footsteps are ordered of the Lord. That means any man who chooses. I believe that means any man who chooses to do things God's way, he's going to lead and guide your footsteps. So what does that result in? What does that look like? Matthew 28, 19 and 20, it reads like this right here. It says, therefore go. What do you say, therefore what? Go. And make disciples of how many, of some of the nations? Of all the nations, not just Jerusalem, right? No, not just America. No, all the nations, baptizing them in the name, and I know what the name is. What's the name?
Jesus.
Acts 4:12 says there's no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. Colossians 2 and 9 says the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him bodily. So what he's saying right here is in the name, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And he goes on in verse 20 and he says it like this. He says, "And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." I told my wife the other day, I said, I'm about tired of playing along with it and acting like everything's okay. When churches start going the way of the world and they start going completely against Scripture, I have a problem with it. I told her in a situation, I don't want to get specific, and I really don't want to be one of those. I don't want to develop a call-out culture in our church where we're calling everybody out in town. I don't think God's called us to do that, but I do want to say this to you for a second. I've gotten to a place where I want to ask some pastors, man, do you really believe? Well, I'm a believer. Are you really a believer? Do you believe the whole Word of God? And the reason I ask that question is because there's a lot of things I'm seeing. A lot of denominations doing some crazy things right now, kind of redefining some things that the Bible says is wrong and saying, well, we don't think that is really meant for this time. Let me tell you something. If you say you believe on the Lord Jesus, that means I believe on the Word of God, every single bit of it. And if someone tells you that signs, wonders, and miracles was for that time, but it's not for this time, mark that and get away from it. Come on, I'm being honest with you for a second. Because the devil wants to convince you that we're supposed to, well, now Christianity has gotten a little more buttoned up, and now our preachers wear polka dot shirts and black suit coats to church on Sundays. I told y'all, you don't want to look under here after service. It's going to be a mess. Now we've gotten educated. We're a little sharper than we used to be. And now I don't really think we need all that. That's for certain times. But let me tell you something. I'm gonna read you something here in a minute, but I'm trying not to get ahead of myself in my notes. But let me tell you something. I believe that God wants to pour out his Spirit on all people. And I believe he's willing to do it at all times. And I want to tell you something today. The only way we're really going to be witnesses, the only way we're really going to teach people to obey everything I commanded you, and surely I am with you always, he says, to the very end of the age. The only way we're going to do that is if I keep myself in a state of repentance every day of my life. God, I'm turning from myself. I'm turning to you. What is repentance? It's not just asking God to forgive you, but what it simply is saying, I turn away from my junk and I turn to you, God. I am going to focus my eyes on you and your kingdom. Now, I know when I say that to some people in the room right now, you're probably literally like, some of you probably kind of like, well, that's good for you. You're a preacher, dude, but I can't spend my whole day thinking about Jesus. They're turning a wrench. Doing it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, bolt, get in that hole. In the name of Jesus. That would probably be better to say than those four-letter words you use when you can't get that bolt to go where it's... Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? When you're working on something, you got bloody knuckles because it slipped a couple... Lord, forgive me for that right there, and bless all the pygmies in our... Anyways. I kind of hit a point where I get it. You got a life to live. You got to do that. I get it. Your mind's not always on Jesus. I understand that. But what about making intentional steps? What about intentionally starting your day off in the right way? What about spending... Sometimes just find a spot, be alone for a minute, and focus in on Jesus, because he's got a call for your life. He's got a call for you to do something. Mark 16:15 says, he said to them, go into all, how much of the world? Some of the world? No, he said, go into all the world and preach good news to all creation. Hey, if your baby's out there preaching to the dogs, praise God, that is all creation. Get out there and tell them. Now, I'm telling you, when I was a little kid, if there's something wrong with a dog, we lay hands on them, and the Bible said the sick shall recover. Don't stop them from that. Let them have some faith. I'm gonna tell, I don't know if I've ever told this before, and I hope Jamie's okay with me telling this story. I'm getting nervous over here now. Oh, Jesus. Here he goes. She's like, oh, God. One time, her dad was sick. I have to tell this story. I mean, hey, God can help anything. Do y'all believe that? Her dad was a pastor over in Augusta, Georgia, where she grew up. And so she was at church, and her dad wasn't in church. One of the assistant pastors had to preach that night. It's like a Wednesday night. And back then, you know, we used to have prayer requests. In a minute, matter of fact, we're going to end this service praying for some things. Had someone fail this morning and hit their head, not feeling too well right now. No blood, none of that. And then my granddad just rushed him to the hospital just a minute ago. But let me tell you something. One thing I know about my granddad, he's full of the Holy Ghost, baptized. I ain't even worried about it. God's got him covered any way it goes. Y'all believe that? I believe that. That's how I look at it. And we're going to pray for some things in just a minute, but it gets interesting sometimes. We put faith on big things, but sometimes we don't want to worry about the little things. But little kids can edit, and they're like, well, you said pray for sick. And so Jamie gets to church, and it's prayer request time. And I'm going to tell you something. The way I grew up, prayer request time, there was no telling what was going to come out. You know, I'm going to be careful there. Somebody's going to be like, you're just a little too uncouth for my taste, dude. You know, well, Jamie stands up, raises her hand, said, I got a prayer request. She said she's about 6 or 7 years old. Her dad would die if he was here right now. And he said, little Jamie, what's your prayer request? Y'all pray for my daddy. Well, what for, Jamie? Now imagine this in front of the whole church. He's at home with diarrhea. Well, all right. If you knew Jamie, you'd know why I was so worried about telling that story. Some things need to stay at home, all right? But as a little kid, they look at things, and you tell them God can do something about it, and they're like, well, why ain't God doing something about it? Yeah. We were somewhere a while back, and I hope this doesn't seem insensitive. I don't mean it at all. But we told the girls, you know, that when people pass away, they go on to be with Jesus. And one of the girls asked them, why is he still right there? And I had that's a ministry opportunity to my kid. I said, baby, because that's his earthly body. See, where he's gone, he's putting on a new body. Doesn't have all the ailments that the old body had. Young and spry, feeling great. And he's walking on streets of gold right now with Jesus. The Bible says to be absent for the body is to be present with the Lord. Like, he's really with God right now. It's a spirit. And one of my other daughters, the little brainiac of the situation, she's sitting there doing this. She turns around and looks at Elise and goes, it's a spiritual thing. Golly, boy, she's even got the prophet movements down. Look at her go. Look at it's a spiritual. I was like, man, we're going to see there's some future in this kid. I mean, kids, like that's a childlike faith. They take it literal when you tell them God can do some things. But see, what has happened is through life, we've let life convince us that God's not quite as great as he says he was. So when I'm up here talking about go be witnesses to the world, they're like, you're sitting there thinking, well, I don't really know what I can really witness about. I want to ask you a question this morning. What has God done for you? And if he hasn't done anything for you, why? Because God's done some great things for me. Look, I get up every day and I take in a breath of fresh air, and if I don't say it, I think it. Thank you, God, for another day. I'm still here. Thank you, God, that I get to do what I do. Thank you, God, that I still have all my faculties, that I can still walk today. Thank you, God, that you gave me 4 beautiful daughters. Yes. Now, God, just work on my wife about that 5th kid so we have a son in Jesus' name. No, I'm just I bumped into a dad, the other big old burly dude, had a button-up shirt, cut-off sleeve, standing there talking. He had 2 little girls with him. And I said, man, something about, I'm looking at this situation. You have all girls? He said, just about. And I said, oh, yeah. He said, I got 5 girls and 1 boy. I said, really? He said, yeah, I sure do. I said, well, I got 4 girls, and you got me beat on that one. I said, I got a question for you. I said, who's meaner, the boys or the girls? He said, girls by far. My God, you should have heard a fight I heard last night in the other end of the house. You get in there, then you get in there to them, and they're laying down. What? I thought somebody got murdered in here. But I get to be their dad. I get to raise them. God gave me those blessings. And even though I'm ready for them to go back to school, you couldn't give me anything to pry them out of my hands. See, I can witness about that. You have a witness. Listen to me for just a second. Luke 24:47, same thing. He says, with my authority, take this message of repentance to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. There is forgiveness. Everybody say that. Forgiveness of sins for all who turn to me. John 20:21 says, as the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. Well, Chris, that was the apostles he was talking to. No. Like when I read the scriptures, I need to start applying it to me. Because if I'm not applying it to me and I apply it to them, then everybody's talking about Jesus being a personal Savior. Well, how's he your personal Savior if you're not even applying him to you? God has sent you into this world. And Chris, why are you talking? This is supposed to be revival week. Listen, God doesn't give us revival so that we can go, woo, that was nice. Woo, what a ride. No, God gives us revival so that it's that spark. I talked about this the other night in prayer meeting, and I'm not going to go into details about it, but I thought I'd talk about it today, but I just didn't feel it. But I do want to say this. There are 3 elements that always have to be present for a car to drive. Do y'all know what those are? Well, we know the structure, we know all that, but there are 3 main elements that make an engine work. You know what that is? Spark, fuel, and air. Now, I didn't look that up. I knew that, and I was proud of myself, because when I said it the other night, I don't really know just a ton about cars. I like cars. Anybody here got a nice car? Anybody got a race car or anything like that? Good for y'all. I asked the prayer meeting the other night. So that's most of you. So that's the car people. Now, let me show you something, though. How many people here would like to have a hot rod or a race car or something like that? Look at that. Look at that. There's a whole lot more wannabe car people in the room. Look, he ain't playing. Was like one of those, was it Yanko Camaros or something, like one of those, we go up to the Fall Nationals every year and watch a little bit of drag race, and Dad just sits there, boy, my God, you know how much that car is right there? How much? That's about $125,000 car right there. Yeah! He's like, wouldn't that be nice right there, boy? And I'm looking at him going, how do you even know how much that car is? He's a car person. He sits and looks at them all the time. But you need those 3 elements in order for that combustion to happen, and all the structure, all the vision of our church and what we're doing as a church, and why I'm trying to get you to plug in is because we have to build a solid structure around that combustion for that car to actually go anywhere. That means I have to get involved. That means I got to go that next step. Go to Growth Track. That's 4th Sunday this month. Don't miss it. Go through Growth Track. Plug in. Join a team. Get involved in that team. And then ask the question, like I said this week in prayer, ask the question, how, what can I do to make it even better? On Sundays when we come here, we do pretty good. We've come a long way as a church, but I feel like God is calling us right now up just a little bit more, because now God's looking at you and says, that's great. You got a solid base. You got some foundations built. You're built on the Word of God. You got some things solid, but now we just need to step it up just a hair, and we can't step it up just a hair without a spark to ignite that air and that gasoline. What is that spark? We need an outpouring of the Holy Ghost in our life so that we'll be energized and empowered. But it's not just for me. Jesus said, as my Father sent me, I'm sending you. Acts 1:8, there was a key point right here, and this is before I can go out, before I can do those things. Jesus says this in Acts 1 and 8. He said, first of all, he tells him to go and wait for the promise of the Father. And it's you look in 1 Corinthians, Paul actually writes a little bit about it. When Jesus rose from the dead, he said that about 500 people were witnesses to him walking on the earth after he had risen from the dead. So some people estimate that before he ascended into heaven, that there were possibly about 500 people probably present at that moment where he tells them these things. And then he pretty much says, sayonara, see you on the other side, and ascends into heaven. And there were even some angels there that spoke to him at that moment. I mean, imagine you watch, I've talked about this on Ascension Sunday this past year. He ascends into heaven. And they're just standing looking, and some angels are there. But I've been in the presence of the one, the Most High, and it's kind of, oh, some angels. Okay, cool. Yeah. Jesus. See, a lot of people, we chase an angel feathers, but we're not chasing Jesus. We're chasing signs, wonders, and miracles, but we're not chasing the source of the signs, the wonders, and the miracles. I'm guilty right here. This guy right here. I know. I've been there before. Because once you get a taste of how great God is, it's easy to get focused on that. But when God pours out, we ought to turn around and go, thank you, Jesus, for that. Now, here am I, Lord, like Isaiah said in the book of Isaiah. He said, here am I, Lord, send me in Isaiah 6. God says, whom shall I send? He's asking the question, who is willing to go? We see in the Bible it says that the harvest is great, but the workers are few. There is a great harvest out there. And I want to ask you the question, River City, I'm like, are you River City? If you're a River City, say it with me. I am. River City. River City is not an institution, it's not an organization, it's not what it is. That is this body of Christ, and if I don't plug into this body, I'm just kind of a tag-along member. I don't just want to be the clothes on this body that comes and makes the attendance look good on Sundays. No, I actually want to be a part of this body and actually help this body move forward. But something has to happen. He says, so Jesus tells him just before he ascends, he says, go to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. And then he says, you will receive. In Acts 1 and 8, he says, you will receive, everybody say, power. Oh, there it is. But you will receive power. Who was the group in the, was it 60s or 70s that had this song? Power. Who was that? Earth, wind, and fire. There we go. See the three elements of... No, I'm just kidding. Kind of, if you think about it. My son, my dad, look, he's over there singing like, yeah, I like earth, wind, and fire, yeah. Son, I think we ought to sing that one on a Sunday. Praise God. This is a key point right here. I'm going to go ahead and read out this scripture, though, and then I'm going to make a point. I want to show you something real quick about that word right there, what that word is in the Greek and what it means. He says, but you will receive power when the comes on you. And you will be my in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Now, there are some people that teach that tongues and all that kind of stuff ceased way back in the old days. But I argue that same power that was given, that power of the Holy Spirit that was given to be witnesses throughout the earth, like America hadn't even been reached with the gospel yet at the point that they say that all of that ceased to exist. Why are you talking about that? Because if you have the Holy Ghost and you're not renewing that in your life, on a regular basis, you're growing cold. And back in the day, we used to call it backslid. And I don't know about you. I heard a preacher say it once, a very convicting preacher by the name of Anthony Mangan. If you don't know who that is, you can look him up. But he said it one time at a conference that I was at with my dad. And he said, if you've ever been closer to Jesus than you are right now, that means you're backslid. You know what I wanted to do at that point? Climb under a pew. Yeah, come on. And I'm asking you, has there been a time in your life where you were closer to Jesus than you are right now? And I'm going to ask you right now, why is that the case? I'm telling you, I'm just going to say this for a second. You can't just come to church on Sunday mornings and punch a time clock and think that's enough to call yourself a believer and to do this. No. It takes a little bit more than that. Jesus, my wife said something this week and it struck me. It struck me in my heart. She was talking about something. We were talking about a situation and I said, you know, we pray for those people. We want God to come to, want them to come to God, and I want those things to happen, but you can't make people come to God. She said, you know what? I've just come to a place where I've come to realize something very simple, that heaven is a place for people that love Jesus. I'm going to say that again. Heaven is a place for people that love Jesus. Not love going to church on Sundays. Not love the idea. Not love the next big conference coming up or the next big worship service that some famous artist is coming to, so we run and we buy the t-shirt. Look, I'm a believer. I even got the t-shirt. No, people that really love Jesus, and it struck me, struck a chord in my heart. And the reason it did is because you start thinking about it. You think about it, even someone working at church. Sometimes you get to the point to where you're doing church, but you're not being church. And I God forbid that I do church my whole life and then stand before Jesus and He goes, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I don't even know who you are. You don't even talk to me." Now, we all say, "I believe in Jesus." People say, "Do you know Jesus?" We've always heard that saying, "Have you found Jesus?" Best comeback I ever heard was, "I didn't know He was lost." But a lot of folks would say, "Well, I know Jesus," but the real question is, does He know you? And see, before my eyes can really be opened, I need to spend time with the Master that can open my eyes. And today I want to focus in for just a second, that word power right there in Acts 1 and 8. Go ahead and put that back up for me, Kagan. That word power right there in Acts 1 and 8. In the Greek, it actually is the word dunamis. Everybody say dunamis. Now, a lot of people, you've heard that word before. It's spelt really weird, but it's pronounced totally different. It's spelt D-Y-N-A-M-I-S. This is Greek for you, and this is why I'm not some Greek scholar, but it's pronounced dunamis. It's a fun fact for you. Just thought I'd drop that with you. What does that mean? What does that power mean? It means strength, power, or ability. I'm going to go through some of these things right here, some of the different definitions of it. The first definition is inherent power. Another word, inherited power. Power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature, or which a person or thing exerts or puts forth. The power. The second thing is this: power for performing miracles. Third thing is moral power, excellence of soul. Fourth thing is the power and influence which belong to riches and wealth. I mean, do y'all hear in these definitions all the things that the Word says, all the things that the Word says that you are? You hear it being explained right there, riches and wealth. Do you know who I am? My Father owns the cattle of 1,000 hills. Do you know who I am? I am a child of God. I am a prince walking in His power. I've been called to perform miracles. Number five, power and resources arising from numbers. Number six, this is big right here, power existing in or resting upon, and this is a big key point right here, power exists consisting in or resting upon armies, forces, or hosts. Now, if we really are approaching the end times, I believe God's going to raise up an army in this end time. I'm not talking about an army with weapons of this world. I'm talking about an army that can speak to situations and God shows up and does what only God can do. An army that is willing to say, "I will do all that I can do so that Jesus can do only what He can do." And this morning, I want you to realize something. You are meant for so much more than just 70 years in death. You are meant for so much more than just filling your belly with the things that make you happy. You are called to so much more than just coming and sitting here for an hour and a half on a Sunday morning. Acts 6 and 8, it actually, Stephen, that word power is used again, dunamis is used again right here, and it says, and Stephen, full of faith and power, or dunamis, did great wonders and signs among the people. Now, here's what I want to get something across to you. When you really start doing things God's way, and this is why I talked about toxic positivity. There is a toxically positive Christianity sometimes, and everybody loves it, and we want everybody to love us. But I want to tell you something. When Stephen walked out and did those signs, wonders, and miracles in the name of the Lord, people hated him for it, and he ended up being killed for it. See, when you walk in what God has called you to do, not everybody's going to like you for it. We did a little worship deal down at the river a couple months ago, and somebody rode by, and he said that he loved all of us. It was a four-letter word like love, but it wasn't love, and it started with an F. You just made me think a cuss word. Shame on you. And then this week, poor Nancy's out there standing where you at, Nancy. I can't see you. Right over there. She's standing out there with a sign saying, free food, come and get it, free groceries. And somebody come by and told her she was, and showed her in sign language that she was number one. I'm trying to give you free food. You're right, I am number one. Thank you. Love you too. Sometimes it doesn't bring us favor in this world to do what God's called us to do. He will give you favor in this world with the people who are willing to be a part of that. That is true. I believe that. But let me tell you something. I want favor with Jesus, not with men. Now listen to me for just a second. Acts 2, 1 through 4. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, talking about that power, and this is what you need in your life. This is why we're doing what we're doing this week. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with how many accords? One accord. In how many places? One place. They were right there in your living room right now watching TV. God, just be a part of what God's doing right now. We ain't even online right now. I came in this morning. I was getting everything set because I'm used to setting for that camera and getting it just right, and I realized something. I could put this thing over here, and it wouldn't even matter this morning. That would be so awesome. We're not even online right now. No, the Bible says they were in one accord in one place, and how quickly? Everybody say, suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Come on, if you're Pentecostal, usually, right now I need some keys. And then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire and set upon each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You want to talk about revivals? This right here is the beginning of a revival that sparked a movement that is still alive and well today on this earth. If it wasn't for and it's interesting that Christians are thinking, we don't need now. We don't need all that spiritual stuff. We don't need all that. It's interesting that some Christians feel that way, because beginning of Christianity, if it wasn't for this power being poured out right here, we wouldn't be here today. I believe that. But here's the thing, we're trying to reach for something. We're trying to do something. God, okay, you fill me with your spirit. You're doing all these, and I believe you need to be a part of what's going on this week, because I think God wants to set you in those. He wants to empower you to walk in what he's called you to do. But here's the thing, we cannot reach what we cannot see. And Wednesday night, I'm going to try to speak to that a little bit. We cannot reach. How do you see yourself? How do you see others? John 4, 27 through 35 says, just then his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want? Or why are you talking with her? Then leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come see. Everybody say, come see. I want to pause right here for a second. What made her turn from, given all the excuses, turn from her lifestyle and then turn to a person who left Jesus from that moment and went back into town and said, come and see? It's because she had an experience with Jesus. And this morning, I want to ask you the question, do you have come and see faith in Jesus? Like, do you tell your friends about, oh, we have a nice little church. It has some programs. It's pretty neat. Like, quit inviting people to church based on the programs that we have, because this is not a program-based church. We have things that are biblical that we do here, but listen to me for a second. Start telling people, you got to come to church and see what God is doing in people's lives. Start telling people, listen, you got to come to church, because when that worship team starts singing and they start moving, if you just lift your hands up to heaven, the Holy Ghost, you start feeling the Holy Ghost move in the room. And then you don't question whether or not Jesus is real. No, you're sure. I have felt his presence. I know that he is real. And see, that's exactly what happened. So she said, come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? They came out of town and made their way toward him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. Then his disciples said to each other, could someone have brought him food? My food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say 4 months more and then the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes. Everybody say, open your eyes. And look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. You know, I'm guilty of it. It's easy to complain about our culture in America right now. It's easy as Christians to sit back and point out everything wrong with our culture right now. I know, I'm with you there. I see it too. But what if God could flip the lenses of our heart? What if God's Spirit could move my life? And instead of seeing all the problems, I see opportunity. Instead of seeing all the waywardness, I see people who are hungry. See, the fact of the matter is, America has been religious for years, and what we call the good old days of America, it really, if you start doing the homework on some of it, was just a bunch of religious times with people who everybody would say, oh yeah, I believe in Jesus, we're good to go. Let me tell you something. The reason I need to come and see the real Jesus and experience the real Jesus is because the Bible talks about, Jesus talked about other Christ. And there's been people following a lot of other Christ. But the Christ I'm talking about is the Jesus of Scripture, who really will empower you to do the things that he's called you to do. Come on, do you believe that? Do you believe God really? I believe he'll fill me with his Spirit. He'll lead me and guide me to do those things. And this brings me to a question I asked you last week. If God answered all my prayers today, would it change the world, or would it just change me? If God answered all my prayers today, would it help me make a maximum impact on this earth, or would it just make me feel better? This week we challenged the people that were in prayer. Start praying prayers beyond you. Start praying over our church vision. Start praying for our community. Start praying for our president and congressmen and senators, for our governors and state legislators. Start praying for them, right? Pray bigger than you. I believe when you start praying bigger than you, God starts widening your vision a little bit. And he starts focusing you in on what matters. So today I'm asking, everybody say this with me as I'm wrapping up. Lord, open the eyes of my heart that I could see the way you want me to see. In Jesus' name. I want to hit you with some points this morning as I'm wrapping up. There are some areas I need to open my eyes to so that we can make maximum impact. And I believe God wants to open our eyes to that spark of the Holy Ghost through a revival in us. And it's going to turn into increase in the fields. There is so much harvest out there to be reached right now. And it's either us. I want to say this to you. If you're not going to reach your family and friends, who is going to reach your family and friends? The first thing is this. Open our eyes to where these people are that you've called me to. Psalm 37:23 says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Proverbs 16:9 says, in his heart a man plans his course, but the Lord determines his steps. How many, show of hands in this room, how many people have ever been sidetracked before because you went to do something. Like I went and picked up some Wingstop the other night, late, and the only one that was open was downtown, it was late at night, and I went down there to pick up some Wingstop. And I get there and I start talking to a young man about something. Fella comes in, he's a homeless guy. We start talking a little bit. We start talking about Jesus. We start talking about all kinds of things. And I help him out a little bit. Took him over somewhere. Got him squared away tonight, and got him some help at that moment. But really, in that moment, what's interesting in the back of my mind, you know what I was sitting there thinking? I sure do want to eat these chicken wings. My wife texted me and said, "I am hungry for chicken wings, but I'm going to bed, man." I said, "Well, good night." We ate chicken wings the next day. And it gets kind of interesting because as it goes, I was driving home with my cold chicken wings. And I thought, you know, that's just like you, God. I had plans to go get chicken. See, a man makes his plans. He plans his course. But the Lord determines this. In other words, I walked in there to get chicken, but I ended up walking out of there holding somebody's hand, telling them, "Hey, Jesus loves you. I don't know what's going on in your life right now, but Jesus cares about you." At 12 at midnight. What's a person have any business out at midnight? I know, I've heard that before. That's where the sinners are. And that's why I was out. But anyway, Jesus said, "Okay." Listen to me for a second. To make a maximum impact, if you want to put this in your notes, and in this semester, we're going to bring those back. Bringing notes back so you can start having your hand out. We've held off on that for a while. To make a maximum impact, we need to connect before we correct. Before I try to correct someone else's course, I need to connect to the one who can help that happen. Because, see, I can't change them. But the Holy Ghost in me can leap onto them, and they can feel conviction in that moment. Just being you ever been in the presence of someone you were convicted to be around? Brother Morton Bustard is a leader in my life, and it's funny because someone asked me one time, "That's interesting you went that route because your personality is so different in so many ways." And I said, "Yeah, the reason I want that guy to speak into my life is because when I get around him, I am shaking in my shoes." You know what I'm talking about? Like, you ever been around a man of God before, and when you're around him, you're still nervous? You're like, "Oh, God, he's going to see everything. He's going to know every thought I ever thought. He's going to know everything. I'm just so nervous." I thought to myself, you know what? If I want to be led and guided through life, I want somebody that makes me nervous to do it. You know why? Because they're not going to let me stay the way I am. They're going to drive me to push forward and to grow. See, God wants to use you to be that influence about, we talked about last week, that influence about people. Second thing is this: open our eyes to see who these people are. So, God, show me where they are. I'm going to guarantee you I can help you with a couple places. Your workplace, kids, school, your own house, grocery store. Boy, my dad, my wife gets mad. I used to laugh at my dad because you couldn't get him out of a grocery store. He pulled over to get one thing. Took 30 minutes. The other day, I'm sitting there talking to some guys in vitamin shop. My wife's waiting in the car. And my phone vibrates, and it's ringing, and I go, "I know exactly who that is. It's my wife." I pick it up, I answer it, I look out the window, she's looking at me, she said, "You done?" I said, "Yes, ma'am, coming out." Open my eyes to who they are. Matthew 9:36 reads like this, our musicians come back. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Have you ever looked at somebody and it broke your heart to see them in the state that they were in? And this is why I heard a preacher say it best just here a while back when he said that miracles don't happen in the arena of faith. Miracles happen in the arena of compassion. God, let me feel what you feel for those people. Let me see who they are and what you want me to do in their life. See, that's what moved Jesus. The Bible said it multiple places. He had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. To make maximum impact, we don't have to be like them, but we do have to. And I want to say this to you real quick. You do have to like them. People don't want to know how much you, don't care how much you know. They want to know how much you care. And this morning I'm going to ask you a question. How many of us in this room found ourselves in a hardened place toward others? It's a dangerous place to be. I want my heart softened toward others. I want my heart in a place where I can love others. Listen to me for just a second. In the name of Jesus. We're okay, all right. Number three is this. Open our eyes to what they need. I want you to say that with me right now. God, open my eyes to what they need. Something just happened in the back, by the way. That's why I paused for a second. That's why I said in the name of Jesus. Okay, let's check this out. How about that? God, open my eyes to what they need. You know, a lot of us, we think we know what people need. How many times you ever heard someone say, that person just needs to get their act together? Raise your hand if you've ever been told that before. You need to get your act together. Yeah. Some people say, you know what you need is you need some discipline. Anybody ever been told that before? Yeah. There's a lot of men raised their hands right there. Your wife's been telling you that, huh? You need some discipline. You need this, you need that. Let me tell you something. What people need is Jesus. I'm here to declare this morning that I believe that Jesus is the answer for every single situation. What am I going to cook tonight? Jesus. Lead me and guide me. I know people like that. Everything they do, it's, what would the Lord have me do? I need to get some gas. Lord, how much gas should I get? My Lord, at least you're talking to him. Come on. Hey, we ought to be happy for people like that around, right? That's just, folks, I just want to follow Jesus, man. Listen to me for a second. John 1:14 says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory. See, this is the problem, is we've forgotten. Raise your hand if you, and I get you, I know I'm getting you to raise your hands a lot. I'm a very interactive person when I preach, but listen to me for a second. Raise your hand in this place if you've ever seen the glory of God poured out and do great things in a church service. See? That right there is your witness. Come and see what the Lord has done. Well, Chris, that happened a long time ago. It doesn't matter. Give them a testimony about what God did for you back then. But here's the thing. I think God's ready to develop some new testimonies in us. Come on, I think God is waiting for us to get ourselves in a place where he can show us some new things. He said, let us see his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. It's my final thought as I'm wrapping up this morning. To make maximum impact, we need to show people the same kind of love God showed us. What does that mean? Unconditional love. Well, Chris, not everybody gets my unconditional love. So you approach, when you say that, you're saying you approach every situation with an expectation on others. I told my mom one time, I said, you know, we got to remove my expectations. People I don't even know. They're not in my situation. They don't know the truth of the Word of God that I know, so I can't expect them to live exactly like me. They may not know the power of the Holy Ghost that I've experienced, so when I approach them, I'm not going to approach them as someone who knows that. No, I want to approach them as someone who wants to show them that. As we stand all over the room this morning, let me... To see people the way Jesus sees them. And I want you to really get this morning. It's a simple concept, but understand it. To see people the way Jesus sees them, I need to look not through the lenses of the flesh, but through the lenses of the Holy Ghost. See, a problem with a lot of us is we have word knowledge, but we haven't, that word has not been given, has not breathed life into us, because I'm not allowing the Holy Ghost to breathe that life from that word into my life. And this morning, I wonder if there's somebody here and you're just not real happy with how your life is going. You're not real happy with where you're at in life, and you're trying to stuff other things in your life to make yourself feel better, but no matter what you do, you just can't make yourself feel better. I want to tell you this morning that I have an answer for you, and a while ago I just told you the answer to everything, and that answer is Jesus. How do I experience Him? The Bible says when Jesus was talking about the Holy Ghost, He was talking about people that were going to be filled with the Spirit. And the Bible says that the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus had not yet been glorified. So how do I experience Jesus in my life? See, Jesus has been glorified. Now He comes back. The Bible says that He tells us constantly that I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm not going to leave you. I'm going to be. How's that happen? It happens through the power of His Holy Spirit. Jesus is more than just the concept. I believe He is an experience. But this morning, it's for so much more. But what can I do in this place this morning as our altar team comes down? Altar team, come on down. Get down here pretty quick because I'm going to give you an opportunity. I wonder this morning as a whole church if we can do. There's a lot of things we want from God, but there's one thing we can do. We can repent and turn from junk in our life and turn to Him. Is there anybody here this morning that's willing to say, I will repent today and turn away from the junk in my life and turn to Him? Come on, as a whole church body, we ought to do that. Now, from looking around the room this morning, it looks like not one single person is interested in repenting and giving their life to Jesus. Now, I'm going to ask that one more time. Is there anybody here that honestly will say this morning, Chris, I don't want to do things my way. I want to do things His way. But this morning, I need that spark in my life to get that going. Well, Chris, I don't feel anything right now. Look, hey, half the time I don't feel anything either. But I'm telling you right now, if you'll step out, you will. God will hit you. Come on, I believe that this morning. I'm going to declare that this morning. If you will step out and surrender yourself, I believe God's going to pour out His Spirit on you this morning. Do you believe that? So what do I do? That same question was asked to Peter in Acts 2:38, and he told him simply this, repent. It starts at repentance. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, or the cleansing away of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, Chris, I don't know if that's for me. That's not true. He says it next. For the promise is unto
you.
Who is you? Everybody say, that promise is to me, and to your children, and to all those afar off, even as many as the Lord our God will call. He's calling people right now. He's drawing people right now. But I'm going to ask you the question. If He's drawing people to His Spirit, does that mean they can be drawn to you because His Spirit is alive and well in you?
Yeah.
Real question. And this morning, I'm not trying to be mean or anything like that. I just want to challenge you this morning to step out and do something different. Step out and shake yourself a little bit. We've been having prayer meetings around this place, and God has been moving in this room. The devil is a liar, and right now I feel it in the name of Jesus. Dad started rebuking and binding some spirits this week. And we need it. I can feel spirits already trying to move it. I can feel spirits go, well, you preached a little long today, preacher. Or you did this a little too much. Or it wasn't that exciting. You didn't say anything that profound. In the name of Jesus. Come on. Bind with me for a second. In the name of Jesus. I rebuke that doubt in the name of Jesus. Come on. I speak against the liar of this world. I speak against the spirit of the Antichrist that is trying to move in and stop what God is trying to do. God, we want your presence in our lives. Come on, if you want the presence of God, shout it. I want your presence. Now I want you to step out all over the room. If you need personal prayer here, you can get it here. But if you just want God right now, if you want to receive what I talked about this morning, I challenge you right now. It's a whole church. Step out of your seat. Push into the altar space this morning. Come on. You guys in the middle right there, give them some space. Push into the altar space this morning as they begin to worship. Come on. Come on, just tell him, God. Come on, pour out your spirit on him. Move on me right now in Jesus' name.
You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I'm seated in that heavenly place undefeated. With the one who has conquered it all. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I'm seated in the heavens. The one who has conquered it all.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me.